All right, there we go. That is my family. My wife and I have been married 14 and a half years. Her name is Karen. We met freshman year in college at Martin Luther College. We had one class together. I asked her out while we were studying for the semester exam, and she said no. Because she was in a relationship with another guy that I was unaware of, and she had been dating this other guy for 4.5 years, and he had Packer season tickets. And So she stuck with him until Valentine's Day of that year, dumped him on Valentine's Day. The two of us went out on our first date later, and I consider it one of the greatest accomplishments of my life that I ripped her away from Packer season tickets. I find that really good. God has blessed us with 5 children. You can see all of them up there. Kaylee is the oldest up here. She's in 7th grade. This is Chloe in 6th grade. Aiden is in 4th grade. Carson is in 3rd grade. Sydney is in 1st grade. They're all a lot of fun. I'll tell you about them all a little bit as we go along here. And that's a picture of us jumping, which we love to have fun. That's all we do at home. Just hold hands and jump and smile. It's a great thing. That picture is taken in our backyard. That doesn't look like the city of Milwaukee, but that is the city of Milwaukee. We've been blessed, very blessed to have nice property that the kids can run around on. This is where I serve. I serve at Garden Homes Lutheran Church, which is on what's considered the north side of Milwaukee. If you're familiar with Milwaukee, you know that what we call the north side isn't really the northern side of Milwaukee. Just back when the neighborhood was founded, back in the 1910s, 1920s, that was the northern border of Milwaukee. Do you know why the church is called Garden Homes? Like, that's not in the Bible. Why is it called Garden Homes? That's the name of the neighborhood in Milwaukee. Milwaukee is broken up into all sorts of different neighborhoods. They each have a different name. And back in 1927, when they founded this congregation, they wanted it to be a neighborhood church. So they named the church after the Garden Homes neighborhood. So that's why we're called Garden Homes Lutheran Church. And that's where I've been serving since I graduated from the seminary in 2004. The very first pastor at Garden Homes stayed there 50 years. The second pastor stayed there 21 years. And I'm the third pastor at Garden Homes. I've been there 10 and a half years. This is a picture of the inside of the church. Very long and skinny, like they made a lot of them back then in the 1920s and 30s. You can cram a whole lot of folks in there. This is it's a picture of us going out for Christmas caroling on Christmas Eve. Every year we go out Christmas caroling in the neighborhood on Christmas Eve. It's probably worse than the neighborhood that you live in. There's high prostitution, high drug use, high crime rate, a lot of violence. Many, many broken families. There's a lot of hurt, a lot of pain. It's not the safest place. But still, every Christmas Eve, we go out and we Christmas carol to the neighbors to let them know that we're there. And we want them to have a very good Christmas. We get great response from the neighbors. They love it. And now we've been doing it enough years that they look forward to it. And they kind of anticipate us coming around. I like this picture because it kind of represents racially what the congregation looks like. We're about 3/4 black, which is unusual in many categories. It's very unusual in the synod to have a majority black church. It's very unusual in the city of Milwaukee to have a mixed church like this. Most churches in the greater Milwaukee area are either about 99% black or 95% white. And so to have a church that's 74% black and 26% white with a white pastor with a majority black congregation, that's highly unusual. Our black members take a lot of heat and some pretty serious heat from a lot of their family members and neighbors for belonging to the white man's church. And it's Milwaukee's an interesting place to do ministry, but there's a great need for it. And on the average Sunday morning at Garden Homes, you walk in and the diversity is incredible. It's really wonderful. So no matter who you are, no matter how old you are, you're probably going to find someone who looks like you. And we want you to feel really, really comfortable. So that's that is the church. But you didn't come to talk about the church. You came to talk about finding a safe place in the storms of busyness and stress. If you are not busy in your life, if you don't feel stressed in your life, then you're in the wrong presentation. And you should go find something else, go take a nap or something like that. But we are talking about busyness and stress. I'm going to show a video now. A couple of years ago, there was a song that came out that it really hit me at the time, really summarized my pressure points in life and ministry, the things that cause me some stress. So I'm going to show that music video right now. You can take a look at it and see if it connects with you on any kind of level here. I hope the volume is loud enough. I think you can adjust the volume over here if it's not.
I look around and see my wonderful life, almost perfect. From the outside, in picture frames, I see. see my beautiful wife always smiling, but on the inside, oh, I can hear her saying, lead me with strong hands, stay.
Popular on Christian radio. You're here, I imagine, because you want to do the best job you possibly can in your areas of life. And maybe you're a little frustrated with how difficult it is sometimes, and that's the case for all of us. That video, that song really spoke to me. It still does, but when it first really clicked, it was just a time in my life that things were just kind of going haywire, stress-wise and busyness-wise, in a way that I just knew wasn't right. And so it didn't take much for the song to just crush me. And let me know, I really need to do a better job loving my wife. I need to do a better job taking care of my kids and being there for my kids. So please don't think I consider myself an expert on any of these things. I've learned some hard lessons in some very hard ways, which I'll share some of those with you with some stories as we go along here. Some of you are probably in a similar stage in life as I am. How many of you are married? Just raise your hand if you're married. How many of you hope to be married someday? Okay, there you go. You know, so how many of you have kids? Some of you probably have kids about my age. Others of you have children who are older, and maybe the issue isn't time that you spend with them right now, but maybe carrying around some regret about things in the past or the relationship in the past and the consequences that has here in the present. And that can be a heavy weight to carry, and we're going to talk about that. And some of you who have yet to be married, who have yet to have kids, we're going to try and spare you some of the mistakes that we all made. So hopefully you find something that you like in the presentation. On the screen right now is what's called the wheel, you know, the wheel of life. There are many different forms of this, but it's a good summary of all the different responsibilities that men have over the course of your life, and probably at this point in your life, you can probably connect yourself into this in some way. Family, friends, career, home, health, faith, finances, and fun. And there is a goal that Solomon lays out for us and when it comes to all the different responsibilities that God has given us. And we find it in Ecclesiastes 3, where it says, "I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and to do good while they live." Nothing better, Solomon says. And Solomon was a pretty wise guy. You know, he knew what he was talking about. So just on your page, I want you to finish this sentence. Finish the sentence as you think about your own wheel of life, all the different things. "I would be happy if..." Then jot something down and share it with someone that you're sitting near. It doesn't have to be deep or profound, but another way of asking the question might be, why in the world did you attend this seminar today? You had your choice of a lot of different ones, a lot of different presenters, a lot of different topics, but something appealed to you about this one. What are you hoping to get out of it? What are you looking for? "I would be happy if..." Write something down. Once you've written something down, then share it with someone that you're sitting near. You talking and giving giving kind of feedback like this makes me feel at home. It's very difficult for me to present or to preach in front of a typical Wells congregation now, because when you're preaching in front of a black audience, an urban black audience, you get a lot of feedback while you're speaking. A lot of nonverbal feedback, a lot of head nods, a lot of, you know, these kind of things, and then every once in a while people are like finishing your sentences for you and saying amen and things like that. So if you feel the need, you can make me feel at home and do it, you know, do all those kind of things, but you don't have to. You can just be yourselves. You can be yourselves too. But you probably had any number of different answers, and they're all very good answers. This is one answer that we'll find in the Bible. In Jeremiah chapter 17, there's a typo on your page. It says Jeremiah 7. It should say 17. There's also a typo up there. God identified this, you know, kind of this goal for men. He says, you know, he identified men. He will be like a tree planted by the water. You can see this tree here that is in the middle of the water, and it's completely healthy, it's completely green because it's right next to the water, it's being fed constantly, and then there are some results from that. "He will be like a tree planted by the water. He does not fear when the heat comes." Can you imagine being a tree with the fire approaching it? "Does not fear when the heat comes. He has no worries in the year of drought. And he never fails to bear fruit." And someone pointed out in the last section, good fruit, not the bad fruit. But he never fails to bear fruit. So those are kind of, that's in a sense how God might answer the question, "I would be happy if no fear, no worries, never fail to bear fruit." So let's talk one by one, just these different categories, just a very quick summary of the fruit God expects us to bear. Most of you raised your hand for being married. The first category that we'll talk about, of course, is marriage. The command in Ephesians 5, which most every one of us would have heard at our wedding: "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church." When you hear that, put that into your own words. What does that mean in your own lingo? If somebody asks you, what does it mean to love like Christ loved the church? You would say, self-sacrificing, willing to sacrifice yourself and everything that belongs to yourself for whose benefit? For the other person's benefit. On the days that they're really nice to you or the days that they're not really nice to you? Yes. What else does it mean? To love your spouse, love your wife like Christ loved the church? Yeah, even on the days that they don't deserve it. Even on the days when it feels like they're stabbing you with nails and hanging you from a cross. You hope you don't have days like that. But even on those days. Yeah. With no regard to if they're going to pay me back for this. It's like not thinking, if I do this, they might, you know, they might be really nice to me. You know, with no thoughts like that. Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Just out of a pure desire to love and to serve. What's the love chapter in the Bible? 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient, love is kind, you know, it does not envy, it does not boast, it's not proud, it keeps no record of wrongs, all those different things. Someone once suggested that if you just replace one word in there, it gives you a great definition of what you should be. You just replace the word love with the word I. So every one of those phrases, I am patient, I am kind, I am not envious, I am not boastful, I am not proud, I keep no record of wrongs. And there's your standard. for what love towards your spouse is supposed to look like on a minute-by-minute, moment-by-moment basis. And again, on their good days, when they make it really easy to love them, and even on their occasional bad days, when they don't make it very easy at all. But that is God's expectation for husbands. Some of you have children. Many of you have children. In Ephesians 4, it says, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. What are some ways that you can embitter your children? Or another way to ask it, what are children looking for from their dads? Attention and time. That's how kids spell love. They don't spell it L-O-V-E. They spell it T-I-M-E. It's the amount of time. And in particular, as a Christian father, what is your primary responsibility when it comes to children? Yeah, to train them in the way of the Lord. Bring them up, you know, bring them up in the way of the Lord, which means teaching them. Can you guess the answer to this? What percentage of Christian families have devotions together at home? 5%? Well, that's really low. I mean, that's really low. Anyone want to disagree with him? Really close. You were actually just a little bit low. 6%. 6% have family devotions at home. You know, taking them to church, Sunday school, those kind of things, you know, that's good. Satan doesn't take a day off on you, doesn't take a day off on your kids. You know, that consistent, just keeping the Word of God as the focus of the home and of the family is so important. It's one that a lot of fathers are not doing. And they're missing out on probably especially if they're neglecting the worship, they're really missing out on one of the biggest ways that a father can make an impact on a child. Do you know the answer to this one? Children who continue to go to church as an adult if their mom regularly took them to church while they were growing up. So mom is a good Christian. She's taking the kids to church every Sunday. She's getting them up out of bed, getting them dressed, making sure they sit still, and you know, and they're working on something productive, the kids' bulletin or something like that. And you know, if mom takes the kids to church every Sunday while they're growing up, what percentage of those kids will keep going to church as an adult? Yeah, you're pretty close. 17%. 17%. You were hoping for a bigger number. It's like, man, come on. The next one is related to it. What if dad goes with them? Nobody's hit it yet. No, higher, yeah, 80%, 80%. There is a reason the Bible says fathers do not exasperate your children, and not fathers and mothers. It's not to minimize the work of moms, and it's not to say that moms can't have a positive spiritual impact. They do in many ways, but just recognize the unique position that God has placed you in if you have children. Is that your children will look to you primarily as the major influence on what, you know, on what they choose to do as they grow up spiritually. Somebody had a hand over here.
Which of these two percentages, which of these two scenarios do you see yourself in as the person who's not with the family?
If you would ask my kids would see me in the second one. Because they consider us going to church together. My kids even want to get up early on Sunday mornings and come to early church with me, and I get up way early on Sunday mornings. But they don't. They understand. You know, they just dad's up front. When somebody else preaches, which is rare, I'm the only pastor at Garden Homes. When someone else preaches, I come and sit with them. You know, with the opportunities, they don't hold my pastoring against me yet. We'll see. The oldest is 13. Let's move on to Christian friends. Spur one another on toward loving good deeds. Encourage one another. This is a good thing that you are doing. This is a godly thing that you're doing. Getting together with friends. How many of you came here with a friend? Any of you come here with a friend? You know, that's a very good thing. It's a healthy thing. Someone once described the Christian community as a pile of charcoal, you know, briquettes, that you take one of those charcoal things away from the pile and what happens to it? Yeah. The one over here goes out. You lose your flame. God intended us to be close to each other and to fuel each other and to be there for each other. As guys, we, you know, like Pastor Jeske said this morning, we kind of like to isolate ourselves a little bit. We don't like to admit when we need help. We don't like to admit that we have issues and that we have problems and that we have burdens. We kind of like to give everyone the impression I'm a strong man and I can handle it all myself. But that's so dangerous for us. Because we isolate ourselves, and it doesn't take very long for us to start losing our flame. Being a good Christian friend is a very important thing. Your career, your work, whatever it is, if you're a student, then that is your work right now. If you have a job, that's your work. Work with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Doesn't matter who your boss is. Doesn't matter what your hours are. It doesn't matter how your boss treats you, how your coworkers are. If you are dreaming about a different job in Jamaica that you would take in an instant that you're never going to get, this is God's expectation that we work as if the Lord is working, as if we are working for the Lord himself. That every day we step into the office or the factory or, you know, if we're working from home or, you know, whatever it is, that that this is my service to the Lord. The next one, your home. I'm sorry to tell you this. Your honey-do list is biblical, the one that your wife gives you. The long list of things that she has for you to do. She has biblical basis for expecting you to take care of those things as well as you possibly can. Work with your hands so that you will not be dependent on anybody. That doesn't mean you have to do all the plumbing and the electrical work yourself. If you're not skilled in those things, do not do those things yourself. You'll save yourself a lot of headaches. But God does expect us to use our time and talents and resources to be responsible for the stuff that he has given us, including our home. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, the Apostle Paul said. You are not your own. You belong to God. God expects you to take care of it so that we all look like this. No, not really. Why does your health need to be a primary concern of yours? Yeah, absolutely. If you're not taking care of your own body, then you are far less likely to be able to take care of the rest. It's like when you're on an airplane, when the oxygen mask comes down, what's the first thing you have to do? Put it on yourself so that you are able to put it on somebody else. A couple of Christmases ago, I absolutely crashed health-wise. I was not exercising. I was about 30 pounds heavier than I am now. I wasn't caring what I ate. I was, staying up late and getting up really, really early, telling myself I have way too much to do. I have to do these things, just killing myself for a long time. I probably couldn't have told you the last time my wife and I were on a date or the last time I spent meaningful time with my children. And a couple of weeks before Christmas, as we're getting into the biggest time of the year for pastors, basically, I came down with severe pneumonia. And it just knocked me out for weeks. My body said, you can't do it anymore, and so I'm going to force you to rest. And it made me, it changed a whole lot. If you think you're just not in a position or you're too busy to be able to take 45 minutes to an hour, 5 days a week, 4 days a week to do some kind of activity, you're killing yourself. In addition to the long-term health, even just the short-term effects of that day of doing something active like that, that hour that you take, you get that back immediately that day, and just how much more productive you are with your mind and your body. Your body will need to take fewer naps. You won't need to, do those short-term recoveries. Invest in something. And my little two-cent advice, do some weight, resistance training, not just like treadmill or something like that. Your body does best when you're pushing against something or you're, pushing or pulling instead of just doing the cardio stuff. You'll know, and like Pastor Jeske said, guys feel a lot better about themselves just in general when they're fit. It's not necessarily a sinful thing. It's just a reality. But take care of your body. Your faith is incredibly important, obviously. It's one of the reasons you're here. 1 Peter 3, always be prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. How do you get to that point where you are always prepared to give an answer? Do you know the Bible? and that's the key. It's a continual learning. Do you have a favorite Bible verse? You don't have to say it or show of hands or anything, but do you have a favorite Bible verse? Like your go-to Bible verse when you're really stressed, when you're really down, when things just aren't going the way that you hope they would? Do you have a Bible verse that you're like, that's my verse? Mine is my confirmation verse, Psalm 46, verse 1, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present, always-present help in trouble. Part of believing that verse means admitting that I need help. You'll see by the end of this presentation, I need help. But it's an active engagement with the Word of God, increasing in knowledge, becoming, in a sense, the expert in your house on the Word of God, so that you can apply it to your kids. When we started out at Garden Homes, we have an elementary school. My kids attend the elementary school. We have about 250 students in the school right now. When my daughter Kaylee, who's the oldest, when she was going to enroll in K-5, with her enrolled at Garden Homes Lutheran School, do you know how many white kids were going to be enrolled at Garden Homes in a student body of 200 that year? One. My daughter. in kindergarten. I love my daughter. You get scared for your daughter for any number of reasons. But man, that has been one of the most faith-building experiences of my life. I mean, one of the biggest things, and of hers. She is so mature in her faith, not because it's a horrible environment, it's a wonderful environment, but her being in the minority culture, in a difficult, among a sometimes difficult majority culture, with a lot of broken homes, a lot of broken families, and a lot of pain, has really forced us to get into the Bible and say, what does God say about this situation? My daughter came home crying today. What does that say about this situation? A boy tried to put his hands down her underwear. What does that say? What does God say about this situation? And those are hard situations, but that's why God gives us his word. And as a result now, my daughter in seventh grade, I mean, there's no other place my kids would rather be. There's no other place I would want my kids to be than where they are right now. In large part because it's forced us to be in the Word much more regularly than we otherwise would. And certainly together, to be able to sit there with your daughter, with her on the bed and me right next to her, and opening up God's Word and saying, what does God say about this? And letting God build both of us together. We have a very strong relationship, my daughter Kaylee and I. A strong relationship with all the kids, but I have lots of stories about Kaylee. I won't tell you all of them, I promise. Finances, God does have expectations for you with finances. Pastor Jeske touched on these things earlier. There's good debt, there's bad debt. I won't go into all of that. Expectations for your church offerings, being generous and being a joyful, cheerful giver, things like that. If you're throwing money on all sorts of whatnot at the expense of your church offerings, that's not good. But it is okay to throw money at other whatnot. That's the last category. That's your fun. God richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. That's the absolute biblical truth. You can go home today and say, honey, pastor said it's okay to go deer hunting. It's okay to be out in the woods. It's okay to say goodbye for a couple of days and just go and shoot some poor little Bambi. And, if that's your one takeaway from this whole thing, I might question you, but but it's okay. God wants you to have fun. Those are all good godly goals. And when you look at all these things, a word that you often hear when it comes to managing all these things is the word balance. How many of you have, you've heard people say, I got to strike a good balance in my life. Can't do too much of this. Can't do too much of that. Got to make sure I'm kind of teetering on the teeter-totter. Make sure I'm in the right place. Do you know how many times the Bible uses the word balance to talk about how we should manage all the different responsibilities we have in our lives? I went through the whole Bible, and on the very next slide, I list every single passage where the Bible uses either the word balance or some form of the thought of balance for managing our lives. And they are all showing up right now. There are none. We talk about balance, and it's good to talk about balance in some ways, but just I don't like how much we emphasize the balance part of what we do in our lives, because balance to me implies like a teeter-totter kind of thing. I'm not going to give too much here, because then I might overdo it, and I'm going to let up a little bit here so I don't give too much, so that I have something left over for here. And the Bible just doesn't talk like that when it comes to our responsibilities. The Bible talks very much about just going all out with everything we do. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all of your might. That means you cannot kind of go halfway in being a good husband to your wife. It means you can't say, I'm going to pull back on spending time with my kids because I'm giving them too much attention. I'm not going to do everything I need to do financially. Mediocre is good enough. God, the Bible doesn't talk like that. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all of your might. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says this, always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Yeah. Yep, absolutely. Yep, you don't want it to be chaotic where you're just throwing yourself in with no regard for the consequences. And we'll talk about that as we go. But just your wife does not get another husband. Your kids do not get another dad. You're it. And God doesn't want you to treat them like they're just another task that you may or may not do. God expects you to be there like Christ would be. For your wife to look at you and feel as safe and as comfortable as she would in the presence of Jesus Christ himself. And I know we're all poor, miserable sinners from conception and deserve nothing good, and we have all weaknesses and failings, but we cannot minimize that or say that isn't real. and that's not biblical. It is biblical. God expects us to fully do all of these things. The work of the Lord, this is your wheel of life. This is really the work of the Lord. God is the one who gets to define what our work is in life and where we throw our energy and how we, you know, and how we throw our energy, which means, you know, and he expects us to evaluate how we do in these things. And one of the most clear examples is when he was sitting by the fire with which disciple? Peter. This is Peter. Before or after the resurrection? It was after. It was after Jesus had died on the cross, after Jesus rose from the dead, and Peter sits, Jesus sees Peter by the fire after a long day of fishing, and he sits down by Peter, and what question does he ask him? Do you love me? And then he asks him a second question. What was the second question he asked him? Do you love me? And then he asked him a third question. What was the third question that he asked him? Kind of. Yeah, it's, you know, the Greek is interesting. In English, our English language falls short in the words for love because we have one word for love. We say, I say, I love my wife, and I love Pizza Hut stuffed crust pizza. And somebody who's learning English for the first time thinks, oh, he loves his wife just as much as he loves Pizza Hut stuffed crust pizza. But that's the impression we give because we have one word for it. The Greeks, you know, in the New Testament, language that the New Testament was written, and they wanted to be more exact with their love to be able to identify different types of love. And so they had four different words for love. And Jesus used two of them in those three questions. The first one he used, the agape love, you know, the one that describes God's love for us. Unconditional, all the wonderful things that we said before about how we're supposed to love our wives. Jesus said to Peter, do you agape love me? And Peter said, yes. Second question, do you know which he used the same one. The agape love. He said, Peter, do you agape love me? And Peter said, yes. But the third time he switched it up. What's the city of brotherly love? Philadelphia. That's two Greek words smashed together. Philia and Adelphis, the word for friendship, love, and brother. Smash those together, you get Philadelphia. That's the city of brotherly love. It's basically saying, do you like me? So Jesus, after he says, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Third time he says, Peter, do you even like me? The first time Peter answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Except he didn't use the word agape. He used the word philia. I like you. He couldn't get himself to say that he did love him. The second time, Jesus said, you agape me, and Peter answered, I philia you. Third time, you know, he said, do you really philia, even philia me? And then it says, Peter was hurt because the third time he used the word philia. Because the third time he said, do you even like me? When was the last time Peter had to answer about his love for Jesus three times in one night? When he denied that he even knew him, just a couple of hours after he promised he would never do that. He said, Jesus, I'm not that kind of man. All these other guys might do it, but I'm the kind of guy, I will never let you down like that. I could see how James might do it. I could see how John, Judas, definitely. I mean, there's something just not right about him, but not me. I mean, I'm Peter. I'm the rock. Remember, you gave me that nickname. That's really cool. And I will never do that. Ever. And then he gets arrested, and somebody comes up to Peter, and he says, hey, don't you know Jesus? And I don't know the guy. And he walks over here, and someone else says, oh, no, weren't you with Jesus in the garden? I thought I saw you. And he says, no, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just tending the fire going over here. And a third time, somebody comes up to him and says, oh, your accent gives you away. You're totally there with him. And he starts going, no, I don't even know the guy. I don't know who you're talking about. And then what sound did he hear? Yeah, the rooster. And then he knew that he was the guy he never thought he would be. He was the version of himself that he had told himself, I'm never going to get there. But he was there. And Jesus was taking him back there. As far as we know, Jesus and Peter had never spoken of this after that night. Jesus rose from the dead. He appeared to his disciples. But Jesus was here and there and everywhere. But they never had a time to sit down and talk about this. And the first opportunity they do, where does Jesus go? He goes to the most regretful moment of Peter's life. The last time Peter was around a fire was that same night, answering about his love for Jesus. I mean, Jesus is taking him back there. He wants him to think about his most regretful moment as a man, as a Christian man. And we don't like to do that, but we have to do that. We have to do that. That's part of being getting to a point where we can start to manage these things. Is we have to identify where we fall short. You know, when it says in Jeremiah 17, he does not fear when the heat comes. That means one question we need to ask ourselves is, what am I afraid of? As a Christian man, what are you afraid of? Are you afraid that somebody's going to find out what you've been into? Afraid that someday your wife is just going to say, that's it? The Bible says he has no worries in the year of drought. That means a question we need to ask ourselves is, what are you worried about? Did you ruin your kids? Are they going to love you? Are they going to respect you when they grow up? Are they going to look back and say, wait a second, I can't believe my dad did that? The Bible says he never fails to bear fruit. That means a question we have to be able to answer about ourselves is, where are you failing in life? Where are you not producing fruit? Jesus wanted Peter to answer those questions. And I want to give you a moment to answer those for yourself. You're not going to share these with anyone. The three questions are on your sheet. You can write answers down if you want, if you don't want to, but I do want you to think about them. I'm going to give you at least 2 minutes just to think about them. But answer those questions for yourself. Self-evaluate what it is about your life that is not, that's just not the way it should be. I'll even play some music here for you. So take about 2 minutes. I'll cut you off. Cut you off then. I'd ask who wants to spend more time at this, but I don't think any of us really like to spend time at an activity like this. But it's important. The son in the middle, that's my son Carson, and Carson is in third grade. I noticed this as I was doing this. You know, look at his face. This is him very recently, and the smirk on his face. He had pretty much the same smirk when he was very little. I didn't choose these pictures because of that, but he hasn't changed much. Since his younger days. But this is Carson when he was a little bit younger, wearing his "My Dad is My Hero" shirt, which he doesn't wear anymore. It doesn't fit. I don't even know if we still have it, but he wore it. He wore it a lot. Carson is a mommy and a daddy's boy. He's always been very cuddly, just wanting to hang out. A couple of sometime after this age, when he was old enough to. That I was confident he kind of knew better when he would do something wrong. I was at a point. It was a Saturday, and I was pretty stressed out. There were just a lot of things going on. Saturday is always a very stressful day for me when I preach the next day because I'm working on my sermon big time. That's my big memorizing day. I put a lot of work into my memorization so that it comes out just the way that I want it to come out. And so Saturdays are always stressful just by themselves. But it was a time in my life when a lot of other things were getting to me too. Again, you know, a time when I wasn't sleeping much. I certainly wasn't exercising all that much. Again, probably couldn't tell you when the last date with my wife was. And it was a time when the kids were kind of getting on my nerves a little bit. I do remember that. I don't know why, but I just remember thinking my fuse is kind of short with the kids. So it was a Saturday about 1 o'clock, and I needed to lay down because I was just exhausted already by 1 o'clock that day, which is not a good sign. But I went upstairs to lay down, and everybody else was home, and I went up to my room, and I laid down on my bed, and I was out. You know, I was out just like that because I was so exhausted. And pretty much the moment I was out, when I, actually fell asleep, my son came running into the room, not Carson, Aiden, and woke me up. And now I'm even more irritated, than I already was because I fell asleep and now I woke up and now I'm not going to be able to get back to sleep again and I'm not going to be able to recover that. And, that's just how it goes. And he comes in and he says, Carson stole my piece of pizza, which isn't a big deal. But Carson had been into a couple of other things earlier and it was just kind of the tip. And I sat up in bed and I was just on a beeline to go downstairs. I asked Aiden kind of on the way down for a brief synopsis of what had happened, and he had a piece of pizza and Carson had just taken it from him and he was going to eat it for lunch, and Aiden said he talked to him about it and Carson wasn't going to do anything, and I went downstairs towards the kitchen, and I'm walking down the hallway and I can see Carson sitting at the table with a piece of pizza between two of his hands ready to take a bite, and I could see in his eyes that he knew why I was coming. And he knew that I was very upset about something, and so he stopped with his bite. He didn't take it, and I walked up to him, and I took my hand, and I slammed the piece of pizza between his two fingers. I slammed the piece of pizza down onto his plate, and I shattered the plate. It was a porcelain plate. Now, never in my life has anyone confused me with somebody who's really strong. or like a kung fu guy who can break bricks or anything, you know, or anything like that. And never in my life has anyone ever confused me with somebody who loses their temper quickly. If you would have asked me 15 minutes earlier, are you the kind of person who will lose their temper and erupt in anger, I would have said, no way. Kind of like Peter told Jesus, there's no way I would ever do that. And yet not managing all the different things in my life, letting a lot of things get to me, feeling very fully stressed, all of a sudden I turned into somebody that I didn't even recognize. And that wasn't even the worst part. Then my wife comes downstairs. And she screams. Because Carson is at the bottom of the stairs and his finger is gushing blood. A piece of the plate had sliced into his finger. And there was a trail of blood going from the table all the way to where Carson was standing. And he's just looking at there, he's just standing there with this look on his face, looking at me like, I mean, I don't even know what the look said. And my wife is there. And the look on her face is the, I don't even know who you are kind of look. And then in the rush of things, as we're trying to wrap it up, and we're making the decision that we got to go to the emergency room and we got to get this taken care of. And as we're sitting in the emergency room, holding his arm up so that the blood flow is above his heart so that it doesn't just keep gushing, so it goes out. And as we're sitting in there for 45 minutes before they took us in, what do you think I was afraid of? What do you think I was worried about? What do you think I felt like a failure at? Everything. Everything. I was the kind of person that I never thought I would become. And then it turned out to be fine. He was okay. He didn't lose any of his piano playing ability or anything like that. Came home that night and I'm sitting in my office in my rocking chair, and Carson comes in. I call Carson in. And what do you say? Some form of the words, I'm sorry, but you know what makes it feel better? You know what his answer was? He still holds my hand. He still loves nothing more than just to cuddle up next to me. His favorite thing to do as I'm leaving for a convention, a conference like today, is to give me the biggest bear hug and never let go until I basically have to force him to let go. Of all my kids, Carson has seen me at my worst. None of the other kids were in the room. They don't even know what happened. You know something they don't. And he still loves me. And he still comes up and sits next to me voluntarily and just leans in and feels safe. What did Jesus tell Peter after he took him to that horrible place, after he helped Peter evaluate just how crummy of a man he had been? What was the command he gave to Peter? Yeah. He said, Peter, I know the worst about you, and I still want you to take care of my most valuable possession in my entire kingdom. He knew the worst dirt, and it didn't change his love for him. And that's what Jesus wanted Peter to see. He didn't want him to see the horrible depth of his mistakes and his sin and stop there. He wanted him to see someone who also knows what it's like to have their fingers sliced, not with a porcelain plate, but with nails, just to show how far God is willing to go to be by your side and to give you everything you need, even on the days when we're making it really hard for him. That's what he wanted Peter to see. There's a passage in the Bible that says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. You know what comes next? Blessed is the man who saw what Peter saw in Jesus that day when Jesus reinstated him. He will be like a tree planted by the water. He does not fear when the heat comes. He has no worries in the year of drought. Those aren't your promises to God. Those aren't your promises to your family that this is what I'm going to be for you so that it's going to be okay. These are God's promises to you. That this is what you will be because God will make it happen. He never fails to bear fruit. That's God's promise to you. On a teeter-totter, what's the most important part of the teeter-totter? It's the base. It's the fulcrum, right? It's the part that doesn't move. It's the same thing with your life. What's the most important part of your busy life? Just making sure you're teetering and tottering on a solid base that's never going to let you down. And they used a cross and some nails and a whole lot of blood dripping onto the floor to show you how determined he is to keep that kind of promise. We all want to be the guys who walk on water. We want to show our wives, we're the guy who's never going to let you down. We're going to be able to take you through this. We want to show our kids that you can count on me. I'm always going to be there all the time. But Peter tried that too. And he got worried. He got afraid. And he failed. And we all know what happened when Peter got worried and afraid and failed. What happened when he did those things? Jesus caught him. When he was worried, when he was afraid, when he had failed, Jesus was still there to catch him. Just like he is for you. Just like he is for me. That's the most important part of all of this. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. What's the next line? Because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. That's God's promise to you. That's not your promise to God. You go all out loving your wife. You go all out being with your kids. You go all out in all those different categories. And that's God's promise. You'll be like a tree planted by streams of water. Whatever he does prospers. Whatever he does prospers. That's God's promise to you. Our times are in his hands. In his hands, it's coming back to the one who manages all the results for us. There are a few tips just for managing all of these things as well as you possibly can. Do we still have time? Am I out of time? No? Yeah? Yeah? Can you give me 3 more minutes? Okay, all right. 4 practical tips for time management just to help us do all of this. The first one is plan and schedule everything. Plan and schedule everything, and this means absolutely everything. If you don't have a scheduled time during the day when you check your email, put it on your calendar. Do not check your email first thing when you wake up. Do not check it last before you go to bed. Do not be the person who's working at their computer and the email thing dings and because it's gonna pull you away. It's gonna distract you, and before you know it, you're gonna be thrown off in a million different directions. You can handle all of your daily email in 2 sessions of email during the day. 30 to 45 minutes each time. Just block it off. That's all you do. Email. Schedule it. Put it on the calendar. Don't touch your email any other time. Same thing with Facebook. What a distraction. I mean, it can be. That comes up in another category here. But plan and schedule everything. Schedule dates with your wife. Put them on the calendar. This is an appointment. I was asked to do a faculty Bible study for another school in Milwaukee, and they wanted me to do it on Valentine's Day. And I emailed back and I said, I can't. I have another appointment that day. You know what my appointment is? A date with my wife and spending time with my kids. That's my appointment. And nothing's getting in the way of that. That's just as important as any work-related appointment. Schedule your devotional time, the time where you get, you know, where you nail yourself down on the base, the time where you will have time dedicated to just listening to Jesus and letting him feed you. Like a tree planted by streams of water, sink your roots down and just soak it in. It doesn't mean you have to read the Bible in a week. It doesn't mean that you have to spend 45 minutes a day, you know, in those kind of things. If you're not in the habit of reading the Bible every day, don't make reading the Bible every day your goal. Just say, 3 times this week, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to try to do 3 times every week for a month, and these are the times I'm going to do it. But schedule everything. Schedule everything. The second one is related. Tell your plan to someone who will evaluate you regularly. Every Sunday night, I sit down at the computer and I write out my entire calendar for the week and then I email it to a friend. And he emails his calendar to me for the whole week that same night. And then Monday at 12:30, we connect on the phone and we go through each other's calendars and we just ask each other, how'd you do last week? This was your calendar last week. How'd you do? Did you make everything? This is your calendar this week. You know, what's going to be hard for you? Just checking in. It's like a 15-minute conversation. That's all it is. But it's important to have somebody that will help you accomplish your goals, because the good thing about conferences like this is that you come away with a lot of good ideas. The bad thing is that you're going to go away with a lot of good ideas. You're going to go to church tomorrow, and it's going to be the best worship service ever because you're so jacked up for Jesus. But then Monday's going to come, and it's going to be like, oh, that's right. This is what Monday is. And then your papers that you took all your notes on, that's on the desk somewhere. And by Tuesday, it's buried under this. And by Wednesday, the mail is on top of it, and all these things, and you forget about it. Plan some ways. Plan for someone who's going to remind you of all the good things that you wrote down here so that they're going to check in on you. You'll be far more likely to accomplish those goals. Number three, burn the plow. Say no to good things. When God called Elisha, what was his occupation before? He was a farmer. Was it bad to be a farmer? No, it was a good thing to be a farmer. But when God called him to be a prophet, what did he do to all of his farming equipment? He burned it up. He burned up the good things the Lord had given him because he couldn't do them anymore if he was going to do the new thing that God had given him. There are certain things in your life that only you can do. Being a husband to your wife, being a father to your child, being an employee at your job. Do those things. Those are the important things. There are other good things that you can do in your life. Playing video games is a good thing. Can be. But if it's getting in the way of a kid doing their homework, then you got to get rid of it. A lot of adults still play video games. 75% of the women who are married to adults who play video games on a regular basis say they are unhappy in their marriage, because the guys give more attention to the video games than they give to their wife. In that case, they got to burn the plow. If there are good things in your life that you don't need to do, burn them up, get rid of them, so that you can do the things that you do need to do. Number four, focus on work, not works. What's the common theme of all those pictures? They're all distracted. He should be spending time with his girl. He's on the computer. She should be watching the kids. She's on the phone. He should be driving. He's doing, who knows, he's texting or talking and drinking coffee and whatever else. There is no such thing as multitasking. There's not. Your brain can't do it. You lie to yourself. You think you can. You think you can do a lot of things at once. Your brain doesn't function that way. It's not productive at all. Even computers don't do that. When you have multiple programs open, your computer isn't multitasking. It's just very rapidly switching from one thing to the next. That's how a computer operates. It has to give all of its attention to one thing. Do the same thing. When you're working for something, on your computer, turn off the email so that those things don't come up. When you're with the kids, don't take the phone call unless you know it's an important one that's coming in. When you're out for dinner with your wife, do not check the score. those kind of things. Focus on work. Guys have a very unique ability to be able to do this as well. This is why when you're watching the game, it takes like five times for your wife to say something before it registers. That's you being a normal guy using your God-given gifts of being able to focus on one thing. That's a good thing to be able to focus on one thing. Take advantage of that. You can tell that to your wife too. So I'm not ignoring you. I'm just focusing. It's a good thing. So always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. It's singular. It's not works. It's the work of the Lord. Focus on the work that God has given you to do at that moment. Do it. Schedule it. Make sure it happens. Especially that work. Last story. Thanks for being patient. I know this is longer than 3 minutes. This is Brandel Champley. He worked for the Golf Channel for the longest time. He was on the road a lot, and my wife and I were reading this devotion book, Devotions for Sacred Parenting, and the devotion was about Brandel Champley. And he was on the road a lot. He never saw his wife, never saw his kids. He was traveling to all these golf tournaments, and one day he came home, just for a short time between golf tournaments, and he was on the way out, and then his kids said, "Well, thanks for stopping by, Dad." And that hit him right in the heart. It just ripped him to shreds. And that was when he decided that I can't do this anymore. So he quit his job. He quit his job and figured something else out so that he could be at home with his wife and his kids. And this is how this devotion ended. He said, where are we most invested emotionally speaking? What is our greatest passion, our truest joy? Is it a hobby, a job, or is it our family? And that's how the devotion ended. And this was, again, at a time in my life when I was not doing these things well. And my wife and I, we have our devotion time every morning from 7 to 7:15, just before the kids leave for school. All right, it's jam-packed in there. It's a good time. We love it. But this devotion, which was about a guy quitting his job so he could spend more time with his wife and kids, this is how the devotion ended, basically saying, are you going to quit your job so you can spend more time with your wife and kids? And we get done with the devotion. My wife is bawling. I feel guilty. You know, it's just a horrible thing. And then we got to get the kids to school. You know, they're at the door. They're waiting to go. And so they leave. And I'm left alone in the house just feeling I am nothing. I'm a horrible, worthless guy that has let my family down in the worst way. And I go through the whole morning like that. And then I start trying to put some rational thought to this, just realizing devotions are supposed to be encouraging, not discouraging. What was discouraging about this was that it put the focus on me and my performance. The most encouraging devotions are the ones that put the focus on Christ and his performance. So I went to the book of Revelation, found this passage where it says, "Let us rejoice and be glad and give him the glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride is ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear." And I texted that to my wife. She was at work. She works till 12:30. I texted that to my wife, along with the phrase that's up on the top there, "Our family is perfect in Christ today." And then she came home. She got home about 1 o'clock, and she was still crying, but the good kind of crying, the one that comes from the gift that only Christ can give and the one that's already been given to you. In Christ, you are already the perfect husband. You are already the perfect dad. Your family is perfect in Christ today. Nothing can take that away. Nothing can change that. Not your performance, not your decisions, not your past, not your situation. In Christ, you are exactly who you need to be at this very moment. That's God's gift to us. It's God's gift to you as you go out and carry out all the wonderful tasks that you've been given. Today you start perfect, and tomorrow you will too, and your spouse will too, and your kids, even though they try to prove you wrong sometimes. But that's what I got. That's all I got. So thanks for staying after. I appreciate it.